So please open your page, Karan Sarida. And we will, before that, we will just chant the invocation prayer, please. Om. आत्मा सत्यम तत् सर्व मिथ्या आत्मा कह स्थूल सूक्ष्मकारण शरीराद्यतिरिक्तः पंचकोशातीतः सन् अवस्थाश्रय साक्षी सच्चिदानन्द स्वरूपः सन् तिष्ठति स आत्मा. So we'll go to now we'll jump to hand over to Swamiji. And Swamiji, all of you, oh, you know, one knows, everyone, most of you know Swamiji.
Yes.
Except for Punekers, Mumbaikers.
Yeah.
Okay. So we studied under Swami Anubhavananji and at Mumbai ashram, Sandeep Rai's ashram. So we are all shishyas of one teacher, and Swamiji is a great jnani. He's a Mahajnani, and so I'll hand over to all of you.
Hari Om, Hari Om, Hari Om. When the question was asked in Tattva Bodh, Tattva Vivekaha Kaha, before I get into the text straight away, thank you for
one moment,
Swami. Should go on mute.
You all can go on mute.
Yes, yeah.
Yeah. So thank you for inviting Mataji to address your students. And straight away diving into the topic, which is my favorite, and that is Tattva Vivekaha Kaha, that is the question for which all this unwanted information is being given. Because the answer to Tattva Vivekaha Kaha, what is this Tattva Vivek? The answer was Atma Satyam Tadanyat Sarvam Ithyeti. Atma alone is real. If Atma alone is real, then what is the consequence of that statement? The consequence of that statement is, other than Atma, everything is unreal. So what about Sthula Sharir, Sukshma Sharir, Karana Sharir? All unreal. But we get fascinated by these things. And the rule is, till you are caught up in something, until unless, put the audio, put your speaker microphone off, it will help. When we are caught up with something, if we want to get out of it, like suppose I'm married and I can't get along, then what I have to do? I have to divorce. How will I divorce? Until and that don't understand that my freedom is restricted in a marriage. So I was smarter. Before itself, I never got married. So exactly the same way, until unless we do not understand where we are caught up in our life, till then you will not be able to chart a path out of this conundrum that life is. Opportunities are at any given moment. Atma is available all the time. And yet we are searching for that which we already are. Then where is the problem? The problem is we have not understood where we are caught up. We have not understood where we are identified wrongly. We don't have to realize Atma. Atma is self-realized. It is your natural state. So when we understand where we are caught up in the relationships, possessions. We are caught up in our senses. We are caught up in our karmendriyas. We are caught up in our mind, intellect. What are these? How we are caught up in them? What is their nature? What is their quality? How do they express? And how do we eventually, I think it will be told in this text, and how do we identify with it? So at the relative level, all this is true. The sthula, sukshma, and karana sharir at the relative level, at the phenomenal level. What is this relative level or phenomenal level? It is other than Atma. So stand apart and look at this whole thing. And as you have already seen, the what was the first one? Sthula sharir. Just in one line, what is sthula sharir? You have, Mataji must have explained everything. Sthula sharir is that, here it says, that which is composed of five maha. That which is composed of the five Mahabhutas, after they have undergone the process of Panchikaran, born as a result of good action of the past, the tenement to earn, the experience of Sukha Dukha and the like, and subject to the six modifications, namely birth, growth, changes, decay, and death, is the gross body, is the Sthula Sharira. Sthula Sharira is where the objects are separate. The sthula sharira experience of life Can you put your microphone off, please? Rajan or Rajan? Okay. Can you hear? So the experience of this sthula sharira is what? Experience of sthula sharira is the objects are others and the sharir is here. And whatever it is perceiving through the senses is separate from the senses. Sukshma sharir, very simply, is that where the object, and Mataji, can you block him? Can you put his audio off on your end? Okay, whatever. Sukshma sharir is that where the object of the thought and the thought of the object, both are thoughts alone. And here, when they explain, what is this sukshma sharir? That which is composed of the tanmatras. We saw that you have already studied all that, and it is 17 in number. That is five jnanendriyas, five karmendriyas, five pranas, that is pranapan, vyan, udan, saman, and the mind and the intellect, that is called the, Chinmayananji used to say, subtle body. Gross body, subtle body. And now we come to causal body. And what is causal body? Anirvachya anadi avidya rupam shariradvayasya karanamatram satswarupa agnyanam nirvikalpaka rupam yad asti tat karana shariram. This is in Sanskrit. If you understand, it's good. I also don't understand, so I have to read. the Sanskrit master, the Pandit is your teacher, Mataji. I don't understand Sanskrit. That, what is the first word? Anirvachyam. Anirvacha, vacha is speech. So what is this Karana Sharir? Anirvachyam, that which is cannot be spoken about. Why? Speech is not available there. Speech is only grossification of the thoughts. Speech that you are hearing right now is grossification of the thoughts. Where are the thoughts? In the subtle body, in the mind. But what is Karana Sharir? Karana Sharir is that where are those? It will come afterwards. Nirvikalpam. It is without any thoughts. And therefore, it is inexplicable. And it's inexplicable in what way? That it is also, and it is not also. It exists, it seems to be existing. At the same time, it is not. Just as darkness. Darkness seems to be there, but actually is not there. Yeah. But something closer to us, wife exists and also doesn't exist. Husband exists, also doesn't exist. Both. That is the nature. So same way, anirvachyam is that which is inexplicable. Anadi, it is beginningless. Oh, Atma is also beginningless. And the Karana Sharir also is beginningless. Yes, it is beginningless. But Atma is anadi and ananta. Whereas Karana Sharir, it may be anadi, but it has an end the moment you wake up. Or that is the deep sleep state that will come afterwards. But this causal body here will just take it as it is anadi and it can be transcended. It can be transcended. Then third point, avidya rupam is in the form of avidya, is in the form of ignorance. Ignorance of what? Ignorance of reality. What is reality? Atma. Ignorance of the Atma itself. So are we knowing the reality that the Atma is subjectively at this moment? If the answer in your mind is coming, yes, no, then anirvachyam ho gaya. If answer is coming, no, then it is avidya ho gaya. If it is coming, yes, then you don't need to study the scripture. Simple. So assess, because you are never absent, you are always present. But this avidya, Karana Sharir, it is avidya rupam. When you are in the deep sleep state, we will look at it more in detail as we read further, that when we are in the deep sleep state, we don't know about anything. We are totally blank, as if someone has pulled a blanket over our mind. And there's nothing to be perceived, there's nothing to be thought, there is nothing to be imagined, there is nothing to be, nothing. And that is this avidya rupam. And sharira dvayasya karana matram. This karana sharir is the cause of the other two bodies. What are the other two bodies? The sukshma sharir, subtle body, and then thereafter the sthula sharir, which is the gross body. Then sat swarupa agnyanam, it is ignorant of its own real nature, as much as the स्थूल शरीर कैनॉट कम टू नो इट्स रियल नेचर, सूक्ष्म शरीर ऑल्सो कैनॉट कम टू नो इट्स रियल नेचर, कारण शरीर ऑल्सो फॉल्स इन द सेम कैटेगरी दैट इट ऑल्सो कैनॉट कम टू नो इट्स रियल नेचर. रिमेंबर वन थिंग, थिंकिंग थॉट्स इज नॉट इक्वल टू नॉलेज. थिंकिंग थॉट्स is not equal to knowledge. As wonderful they may be in Sanskrit, such beautiful anirvacha anadi avidya rupam shariradvayase karanamatram sat swarupa jnanam nirvikalpam, beautiful words, but this is not knowledge. At relative level it is knowledge, but from absolute point of view it is equal to ignorance. But at relative level, yes, instead of pursuing knowledge of the world, we pursue the knowledge that take us to the threshold of the Atma. And this Karana Sharir is very close to Atma, very close. All you have to do is remain awake. And not go to sleep while I'm talking. Or not go to sleep when you are meditating. That's the only thing that is required. When the mind, when you are doing your japa, chanting or meditation, vaikari madhyama pashyanti para, as your gross speech becomes subtle speech, becomes causal speech, then and you go beyond it, don't go to sleep. There you are. You are with the tattva. You are the tattva then. If you can remain awake when the karana sharir is expressing itself, in other words, if you can remain awake in deep sleep, story over. So don't, my approach is like this, okay? Because my approach is always not to indulge in too much. Understanding is important, but I never forget to keep bringing my mind towards the ultimate destination. And that ultimate destination is that I am already that which I am seeking. So what is the obstacle in between? This Karana Sharir, can it become an opportunity? Yes, it can become an opportunity for me to transcend. Because naturally you are going to sleep every night. You don't have to try to go to sleep. You live your day fully well and you will go to sleep. Now, question is, when you are going to sleep, can I remain awake and not take sleeping pills after that? Again, problem otherwise. Many people say they are having a problem in sleeping. Nowadays, my mom is going through that. So it's a God-given gift. You're awake. Take your mantra and let the mind be calm. Eventually, in few days' time, few weeks' time, it will become calm. The bliss that you will experience as a result of that, you can't compare with food, with people, with relations, with possessions, with experiences, imaginations, God, everything will be gone. Anyway, then next one is sat swarupa ajnanam. It is ignorant. This karana sharir is ignorant of its own real nature. And what is what is its own real nature? It is the self. Then nirvikalpaka rupam, it is nirvikalpa. Vikalpa is the thought. Nirvikalpa, without thought. Without any thought of name and form. See, we talk about nirvikalpa samadhi. What is nirvikalpa samadhi? Exactly what I told you. Nirvikalpa samadhi is that where you are awake and the mind is quiet without any agitation, without any thought eruption. So yes, you are recognizing, you are understanding what Karana Sharir is, but how can it become a stepping stone for us to land back into ourselves as ourselves? That is important. Karana Sharir is not important. Understanding about Karana Sharir so that we can discard it, so that we can use it to reach the goal. How would you use the subtle body? Similarly, in subtle body, you have to do the chanting. You have to, anyway, Mataji must have said something. I don't want, that is a different matter. We are here only in Karana Sharir. Let's only do justice to this one. Free from duality of division. Thoughts appear only where there is two. Thought cannot be present. Thought cannot erupt. Thought cannot formulate where there is only one. Thought can come about. Thought can take form only when there is duality. And what is this Karana Sharir? It is free from duality, a God-given gift, which you and me experience on a daily basis for good. Mataji experiences only 4 hours. We experience for longer. 6, 7, 8. See? So God-given gift. Naturally, the mind is quiet, man. Now, if it is quiet, again, from sadhana point of view, how will you make it into an opportunity? Can you make it into an opportunity when you are sleeping? Not possible. Then when it is an opportunity, just before you get sucked into sleep, that is the moment of your alertness to convert sleep into samadhi. And the second opportunity is when you wake up. The moment you wake up, instead of getting into any activity, brushing teeth, doing this, scratching yourself, tossing and turning on the bed here and there, just lie there, dead. You are awake. The world hasn't entered the mind yet. It's absolutely quiet. That's another window of opportunity to be in Nirvikalpa Samadhi. Don't miss it. Every day, two opportunities we are getting. So, Nirvikalpa Rupam Yadasti Tat Karana Shariram. Such is this Karana Sharir or the causal body. Here is, do you read the Tattva Bodh text or what do you do, Amma? Mataji? Do you read the text? Yes or no? Read. Okay. A man in deep sleep experiences a happiness or bliss resulting from the absence of identification with the body and the mind. What does this statement mean? That when we are in deep sleep or when we are in Karana Sharir is equal to deep sleep. And in the deep sleep, we are not identified with any object. There is no object to be perceived. There is no object to be imagined. There is no object to be referred to. Therefore, there are no thoughts. What is darkness? Is there something called darkness? Or is it only absence of light is called darkness, right? So absence of the sthula sharir and the sukshma sharir is karana sharir. Now you try to work it out. My God, you are saying absence of light is darkness, absence of sthula sharir and sukshma sharir is karana sharir. But just now you said before that karana sharir is the cause of sukshma sharir and a sthula sharir. This is the conundrum that we have to solve. And it cannot be solved because it is the sthula, sukshma and karana, the waking dream and sleep, if you want to take it that way, because sthula sharir is only available in the waking, sukshma sharir is only available in the dream, and in deep sleep there is no sharir available. And if you know what, you know what is the meaning of sharir? Sharir just doesn't mean, in English it means the body. But there is an equation, I can't remember, as I told you, I don't know Sanskrit. But it means that which is continuously depleting. That is called sharir. That which is continuously wasting away is called sharir. So are the waking, okay, we'll go into that three avasthas later, but here we are not identified with anything because there is no object to be perceived, imagined, contemplated upon. When there is, and as a result, we experience the ananda. See, we are of the nature of Atman, and because we do not accept that we are the infinite reality at any given moment, therefore, we are searching that bliss, which is our nature, with whatever is available. What is available? Through sukshma sharir, through sthula sharir. Sukshma sharir, how does it experience bliss? By interacting with the sukshma jagat. Sthula sharir, how does it experience bliss? By interacting and wanting and desiring experiences from the sthula jagat. But in the deep sleep, in the karan sharir, or the deep sleep, there is no jagat available. Both are absent. And because the bliss, the total bliss, it's not broken up by any desire for anything. Because what is desire? What is bliss? Bliss is, if I don't know if that was the topic somewhere before, but when we desire or want a particular object, the moment we become one with the object, the desire for that object stops in our mind. And when the desire stops, the bliss that is inherent, that expresses forth. Now, in karana sharir, in deep sleep, there is no desire. So you are continuously in bliss. But we don't know that while we are sleeping. Someone knows. Who knows? Can it be the waker who knows? Oh, I had a wonderful sleep tonight. Can the waker make that statement? Because he has to be obliterated in order for sleep to begin. He cannot do that. So who is that? Who knows? Someone must be there. And that fellow is answering, oh, I had a wonderful sleep. It is not the waker who's speaking. Someone else is speaking, who was awake even in deep sleep. That is the true you. But we are hoodwinking ourselves into believing, oh, I am the waker, I am the dreamer, I am the sleeper, I am the gross body, I am the subtle body, I am the causal body. I was born, I'm going to die, I'm going to do this, all the drama. During this state, one is completely ignorant of anything that is, one has an experience of nothing in particular. I explained this already. During deep sleep, one is under the influence of or identified with the causal body, means one is identified with zero, nothing, absence of everything. So what is the important point here? You are still identified with something. At the current sharir level, you are still identified with something. And that something is ignorance. That something is the current sharir. That something is absence of waking and, absence of sthul and sukshma. You're still identified with something. Because our attention is outwards. So first, when the gross body is not there, oh, I'm not the gross body, I am the subtle body. Then subtle body also goes away. I am not a subtle body. But there you have deeply programmed lifetimes. Can you program yourself in deep sleep? Not possible. Then when did you program? In the waking. Mummy came and every day she told 8 o'clock, 7:30, go to sleep, go to sleep, go to sleep. And you came to this conclusion. Sleep means I have to dive into nothingness. Where I am disidentified with the sthula sharir, I am disidentified with the sukshma sharir. That is sleep. During deep sleep, one is under the influence of or identified with the causal body. During this state, one is free from the dualities created by the gross and the subtle bodies. And therefore, this state is described as nirvikalpa or devoid of qualifications. There is no qualification. There is no vritti. There is no thought. Qualification comes about when two come together. There is a knower and a known. When two come together, there is a thought is possible. Triputi is required, na? You must have studied that in some other text.
No, this is the first text.
Oh, this is the first text. Then I'm going too deep then. Forget it.
It's good. Please do.
So for every thought to be created, there should be I, there should be you, and there should be right now, there is a seer, that is me, seen, that is you, and there is seeing taking place. So now when I say, I see Mataji, so I see is the instrument and Mataji is the object. Until these three components don't come together, a thought cannot be formed. Whether in the dream, whether in the subtle body, or at the gross level also, senses also, they cannot see, hear, touch, feel, taste, etc. For everything, these three are required. But in deep sleep, these three are not there. Why? Because the object is not there. For the I to identify with something, no object is available. When no object is available, it says, oh my God, there is nothing available. So it gets identified with nothing. And that is this Karana Sharir. That is the deep sleep state. The causal body is indescribable, anirvachaniya, or inexplicable because this state of ignorance is neither sat, existing in all the three periods of time, nor asat, non-existence. Why it is not real? Because real is that which is always present. As a student, you think, what is always present? Is the gross body always present? Is the subtle body always present? Subtle body, just take it as mind. Are the senses and the body always present? No. Is the gross world present all the time? No. How can you say, sir, it is not present? Why? When you are dreaming, is the world available to you? We are talking about subjective approach. When we study the scriptures, it has to be subjective. Subjective means everything pertaining to this I. not a generalized principle. Not that person said this. What about when I am dreaming or when I am sleeping? Isn't the world outside there? For whom? Is that world which is outside there, are you available to it? No. You are not available to the world. You are available to the dream. So that's why you are not a waker, you are a dreamer. That will be the next topic. When waker and dreamer both are not available to, and because they have got nothing to perceive in the gross or the subtle world, then because of the habit of identification of this I, when it doesn't have the sthula sharira to identify with, the senses to identify with which it used to identify with the objects of the waking world, it doesn't have the subtle senses or the mind to identify with. It doesn't have the mind to identify with imaginations, that is the dream world. When both these are absent, because of this habit of identification, this I, this jiva, this relative I, he says, oh, I have got nothing to identify with now. And that very moment, it dives, the sleep takes over. And if, point to note, if thinking about emptiness, if thinking about nothingness, if thinking about absence, we go into meditation, it is called jada meditation, jada samadhi. Meditation is necessarily when our attention is on the self, not on absence. This slight shift of attention is all just slight shift of attention, and the story is over forever and ever and ever. And because we have been ingrained over lifetimes and this lifetime to remove that default setting, we are studying these scriptures like Tattva Bodh, which is a preliminary text, so that we understand our composition, what we are made up of, how we are caught up by our own choice, foolishly. So our approach when we are studying even these preliminary texts, yes, on one hand, you understand like a mechanic understands the various parts of the car and is able to put it together. So this is the car. You are understanding the various parts which make this car function. Its functioning is not only in the waking world. Its functioning is also in the deep sleep. Its functioning is also in the dream. No, you have to not, but how we have invested ourselves? We have invested ourselves only with the waking. Spirituality or self-inquiry, coming to your original self, necessarily requires addressing all the three, everything that you have wrongly accepted to be I, everything. But you, me, we all of us, in general, we have put all our eggs in the basket of waking only. So we have relationships here, we have possessions here, we have memories here, we have photographs, we get married here, we do so many things. And we think this is real, and dream is a dream, and deep sleep, that is the time to rejuvenate. We have to understand, when we give equal importance to all three, then alone we can transcend the three. Then alone, we can be the Sakshi, he will tell you here afterwards. then alone we can be the sakshi of the three. Sakshi of the three, sakshi of sthula sharir, sukshma sharir, karana sharir. In other words, jagrat, swapna, sushupti. Keep this approach in mind. Study everything with view to be the self at any given moment. That is our goal. To be the self, not become realized. Nobody has become realized till today. Because realization is your natural state. That is your default. A wave is ever realized as water. What efforts can it do? How many scriptures can it study to realize that it is water? Think, contemplate. When I put this example in front of you, you think, stupid. Water, wave is already water. Exactly the same way. You are already that which you are seeking. This statement came before, isn't it? When the topic of Atman came.
Yeah.
Yeah. So now, if you are already that, now don't go around beating the drum. I am realized. Why are we not experiencing the bliss of realization every moment? Because there is corruption of identification. We have not given zero value to the sthula sharir. We have not given zero value to the sukshma sharir. And we have not given zero value to the karana sharir. In other words, we have not given zero value to the jagrat, waking, dream, and deep sleep. Until unless we do not give zero value to these three, we are very easily able to give zero value to the sleep. We can give zero value to a dream, but we are unable to unclutch ourselves, disentangle ourselves from the waking, from the sthula. This has to be brought about. To bring this about, we are studying these scriptures. And scriptures can be studied only in the waking. They cannot be studied in deep sleep, correct? And they cannot be studied in the dream also. Why? In the dreams, the thoughts are going so fast. You can go through the entire evolutionary process from an amoeba to a god being in one dream. You can be born many times in a dream. One moment you are a man, another moment you are an animal, another moment you are a woman, another moment you are a mother, another moment you are a father. So many, all mix and it's, thank God we forget it the moment we wake up. And we say, it's only a dream. But what is happening in waking? Waking is slow compared to the dream. And because it is slow, we can reorient ourselves. We can shift our thoughts from going outwards to inwards. We can understand in the waking. Therefore, scriptures are studied in the waking state. And by studying in the waking state, what are you doing? Giving zero value to the waking, zero value to the dream, zero value to the deep sleep. Zero value to sthula, sukshma, and karana sharir. Now this language, as we keep going ahead, it will be very contradictory. Because when he says, it seems to be the karana sharir is sat and asat at the same time. It is also because we go through the deep sleep state. And it is not because absence is not an object to be perceived. Absence is not an object, just as darkness is not an object. Now, this becomes a problem for us. No, don't let it become a problem. Because phenomena means, I'll give you one example, simple, which is more relatable. and that is, you are a man or a woman. Now, out of you, a husband or a wife is expressing, right? Or a mother or father is expressing. Now, you are a father, you say yes. You are a man, yes. Then which one are you? Are you father or are you man? So you say, I am man. Then what is father? It is a hat that I wear. It is a role that I play. What is the nature of this role of father? The father role is, but at the same time, it is not, because only man is. Similarly, this Karana Sharir also, it seems to be there because we go into deep sleep, but actually speaking, there is nothing. Reassessment of our experience is being presented to the student of Vedanta. Reassessment of the equipment, reassessment of the experiences that you are going through, what you are surrounded by, how this individuality or how this world, how this gross, subtle and causal body, everything, what are they composed of? How did they come about? Everything in detail is told for whom? For he or her at this moment who wants to know what is their real nature. Not for collecting information. And then in a party, I started Vedanta class. I studied Sthula Sharir, Sukshma Sharir, Karana Sharir. It is not for someone else. It is our own, for our own assessment. Vedanta has to be practiced on one own self. Love has to be practiced on everybody else. But we love ourselves and impose Vedanta on others, like I'm doing right now. See, it should be the other way. When you are in the world, love everyone as they are. Be non-judgmental, unbiased. When you are with yourself, in meditation, in japa, in your own, with, there's no one to disturb you, be very critical of yourself. Be ruthless in assessing who you really are, and be ruthless in throwing away that which you are not. So, sthula sukshma karana, you are not. Who are you? The Atma. Have the courage, have the magnanimity, have the focus, have the mumukshutvam, have the intense desire to be the self. Just like you have intense desire every night to think of sleep, to want to be surrender to sleep, and you think, and all your activities in the daytime, in the waking, you change into pajamas, you put the light off, you get into the bed, you get into a particular position, you get into sleep. You are still thinking of sleep, you are not gone to sleep. But all your activities are dictated by the desire to sleep. When your desire to be the infinite self is so strong, all your activities will be dictated by that desire. When that happens, you are called a sannyasi. All our activities are dictated by the self. This mumukshutvam has to be there. Intense desire to liberate. So every night when you till the last moment when you have not gone, when you are thinking of sleep, I don't want to think of anything, I don't want any projects, I don't want any imaginations, I don't want any dream, I just want to dive into the womb of this, into the lap of the sleep, not womb, lap of the sleep. When you are thinking of sleep so intensely and wantingly and ready to surrender at it, in front of it, do you give up the world or the world goes out of you? The sthula sharira goes out of your mind. The senses go out of your mind. They stop having an impact on you. The dreams stop having impact on you. Automatically everything keeps going away. Urvarukameva bandhanat mrityor mukshiyam amritat. They just keep dissolving away. And when there is nothing to dissolve anymore, then do you need to think of sleep? No. Then the thought of sleep was only there to counteract all other thoughts of sthula, sukshma, jagrat and sapna. When there is nothing left to be deleted, to be dissolved, to be melted away, then the thought of sleep is also not required. It automatically drops away. Exactly the same way. Exactly the same way. You are mumukshu. You have intense desire to be the self. Think of the Atman. Allow the world to leave your mind. Then the thought of Atman, when you reach that peak, when you reach that climax, when you reach the acme of contemplation, completely integrated and synchronized with Atma, the thought of Atma also drops away. So how do we use sthula sukshma? If your attention is on sthula, you will only do yoga. If it is on sukshma, say breath, then you'll do pranayam. If it is on mind, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. All that is required, no doubt. But who are you? Are you the sthula? Are you the sukshma? Are you the karana? Or are you the one who is knowing that every day waking, dream and deep sleep are coming and going on a daily basis, aren't they? So you must be other than these three. You must be other than the waker, dreamer, sleeper. For the waker, there is a waking world. For the dreamer, there is a dream world. For the sleeper, there is no world. But who are you? Who knows that these three states, that's the next one which Amma will take afterwards. You are the one who knows these three come every day and go away. So you are the unchanging one. You are the unchanging one. And what is unchanging one? The truth. What is unchanging one? The Atma. What is unchanging one? Oh, that I am. That is my essential nature. And what am I living as? I am living as pathetic. I am living as father, mother, daughter, sister. I am living as sthula, sukshma, karana. But what am I essentially? I am that which is never changing. Atma is never changing. Sthula keeps changing. Sukshma keeps changing and karana also keeps changing. Karana sharir, the deep sleep, may be the cause of waking and dream. But what am I going to do with that information? Do I want to indulge in that? No. Information is there. Okay, accepted. It is the cause. What does it signify? From nothing, everything has come. That is what it is telling us. Deep sleep is a state of nothingness, emptiness. Emptiness is not an object. Out of that absence, the waking and dream, everything has come. So what is the status of waking and dream? Also nothing. How can something born out of nothing be something? Not possible, no? So this is the causal body. It is also called avidya rupam because of ignorance of which it consists is opposed to subjective knowledge. Subjective knowledge is only one. I am the self. Time ho gaya. I am the self, time ho gaya. Rest amma can take. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.